So hi everyone, and thank you for coming, and thank you for staying late. So yes, last year, one of our customers came to us with quite a challenge. They wanted to run our software, our Java software, on more than 10 terabytes of memory. And we met that challenge. So if you're here tonight, I expect that you like this kind of challenge yourself. So first, you're in the right place. And secondly, yes, this is possible. And tonight, Nida and I will tell you all the steps we went through to do this. But first, let us introduce ourselves. So I am Antoine, Chambille. I'm the head of R&D at Quartet FS. And with my teams in Paris and New York, we write ActivePivot. ActivePivot is the fusion between, I would say, an in-memory database and a calculation engine. And it's all written in Java.
My name is Nida Bouzid. I'm leading the APAC team for Quartet FS. We have offices in Singapore, Hong Kong, and a small presence in Australia. Yeah, you can carry on.
That's all. Yeah, so here is our agenda for tonight. So we will describe the application that we have tested, and then we will talk about hardware. I mean, how does it look like, a server with 16 terabytes of memory? But then we will jump into the heart of the matter, how to operate a JVM on 16 terabytes of memory. So we worked on a financial application, a credit risk application. So give me just a few minutes to give you the business context. So credit risk estimates the money that a bank may lose because of counterparties that default. And of course, there is no formula to tell you when a counterparty will default. So credit risk is estimated from probabilities and Monte Carlo simulations. So a credit risk engine really will simulate the market conditions in the future thousands of times. And for each time point along each of those simulated paths, it will calculate the value of all the positions in the bank. So this gives you hundreds of billions of values, so terabytes of data, that when you aggregate them the right way, give you an estimate of credit risk. And of course, in the past, those kind of systems were run in a nightly batch processes, producing pre-aggregated reports in the morning, maybe. But this approach today is proving its limits. First, the financial regulators say that pre-aggregation and pre-canned report destroys information. They say that the risk analysts today, they should be able to freely select and filter from the granular data and aggregate on the fly along any attribute that they want. And in parallel to those regulatory requirements, the banks themselves want to do more than just static reporting with their system. Their goal is to help their traders and their sales and let them use the tool interactively while they have a customer over the phone, maybe. So transforming a batch system into an interactive system. But of course, when you aim for that level on terabytes of data, it becomes a problem of very fast aggregation on huge volumes of data. And that's precisely the kind of problem that ActivePivot, or platform, solves. And so what is ActivePivot really? Very quickly, it's an in-memory database with all of the high-performance elements that you could expect from an analytical database. So, for instance, column stores, multi-dimensional aggregation accelerated by bitmap indexes, and of course, multi-core calculation. But what's more relevant today is that it's all written in Java. We made the choice of Java very early for our system to do high-performance in-memory computing. And the reason for the choice is that Java is fast, or at least reasonably fast. But more importantly, it's also safe. I mean that Java will not core dump your application when you do a mistake or an error. And also, Java is very accessible. With more than 20 million Java developers in the world, that's what I heard. And it's easy to extend, and that's what makes Java the right choice. That's what made it the right choice for the vision we had for ActivePivot, which is to bring the business logic close to the data and being able to do on the fly and interactively those calculations that used to take hours. So this was our vision for ActivePivot in the beginning, but I can tell you that we never expected that we would be running Java on that kind of hardware. Right? So here is a selection of large memory servers that we have certified or that we are testing with ActivePivot. And each of those servers has a little backstory. So for instance, the big Oracle Spark server, that's the one everything started with. Last year, when Oracle heard about the challenge that our customer gave us, they joined forces with us, and they helped us do it for the first time. So they built a team of system engineers, JVM engineers, and they worked with us to make this possible. So it all started on the Spark server. Another of my favorites is the first one, the Bouillon server, because it is made in France by Atos Bull, right? And it's an interesting server because you can see from its look that it is modular. So, in fact, you can start with one module and 3 terabytes of memory and add modules when your application scales up or unwind and scales down if you need. And also, this is an important partner for us. We've been, our R&Ds have been closed for 2 years now, and Atos now has an appliance, an ActivePivot appliance that they sell based on the Bouillon, of course. And then if you're looking at the maximum size of the memory, I guess FGI and Huawei are the current leaders because they can go up to 48 terabytes of memory per server. And the truth is that in a few months, you will be able to multiply all of those memory quantities by 2 when the new memory chips with 128 gigs per chip will be available. So, you know, it's not going to slow down anytime soon. And of course, the big players, also HP and IBM, they also have their big memory servers. And maybe that's the important information to keep to that. All the vendors now have those big memory servers. So there is some competition and the prices fall. And it means that those large-scale in-memory applications are becoming mainstream. Yes, there is a special interconnect to link like several motherboards inside the server, but it's really one server each time. One operating system, Linux, and one server, one shared memory address space. No cheating.
So when you look at those hardware configurations, there is something disproportionate about, because we're talking about terabytes of memory. If you ask some Java developers and you say, what do you think is the maximum Java can handle in terms of memory, you can find this on some blogs, or maybe some people will answer you maybe 100 gigabyte of RAM. Here we're talking about tera. You have also to understand that ActivePivot is today running on deployed on production servers, on servers having 1, 2, or 3 terabytes of RAM. So that is really possible thanks to many efforts that has been made by Antoine's team on the ActivePivot code itself. So let me walk you through this journey. First of all, we had to start by minimizing the Java heap and manage the memory ourselves. How to do that? To do that, we relied on what we call the buffer. The buffer exists since the JDK 1.4. The buffer allows you to allocate what we call the memory off heap, no more in the Java heap. And if you never heard about it, in short, the buffer is no more than a primitive, see, like a primitive array. So let's have a look at a classic code that is allocated in the Java heap. Here I'm allocating an array of 1 million doubles and then doing some operations on it. So the same code can be written by using the buffers. So here I'm doing some, I'm allocating some memory, but this memory is allocated off heap, and I do the same type of operations. Those direct buffers are used in what you call the memory mapped files, in the high performance network streams. But in our case, in the case of ActivePivot, what we want to do is just use them as a malloc, for those who remember the C courses or those who practice C. So we want just to use them to allocate the memory. So then what we discovered is, by using those direct buffers, we had some overhead because of the NDNS, boundary checks, method calls. So what we had to do is to reverse engineer those buffers and use only this, the minimum. So in short, we ended up by using sun, misc, and safe.
Who has used that already? Who has used unsafe before?
You don't be afraid, because the name is unsafe. Like a few years ago, if you say, hey, I'm using sun, misc, and safe, so people will say, oh, this is not that classic. Nowadays, this becomes more common. Just if you Google it, you will see that Oracle tried to give up sun, misc, and safe for the JDK 9. So then this would have broken many of your favorite frameworks, like Netty, if you know, and many others there. Actually, I found a page listing all those popular framework using sun, misc, and safe. It's probably hidden for you, but they're using it behind the scene. So this explained how popular is sun, misc, and safe among the Java community. However, there is something that is not that magical here. You cannot put everything off heap. For ActivePivot, being a database, in memory database, what we need to store is mostly primitives. So this works really in an efficient way if you use colons, hash tables, indexes, but doesn't work well and doesn't work at all for serialized objects. ActivePivot is also an API. It comes with its own API. So we tried to find the right balance. We didn't want to expose this low-level API to our users, to our customers. What we did is we kept all those raw data that is used by the database, we kept this off-heap. And then all the calculations and all the queries that are fired to the database will run on heap. So by doing that, we had the right balance for the performance, and we didn't degrade anything for the performance, and we kept all those raw data of heap. And for the Antoine use case, for the CVA he just exposed, we had to use 3 terabyte for the heap and 12 terabyte of heap.
That's right. 1-to-4 ratio. But let's return to the question.
Can you guys maybe tell us, like, not necessarily explain how you did it, can you explain like why this was done in one JVM, like instead of a bunch of microservices first?
You mean why one JVM instead of scaling out?
Yeah.
Well, there are some workloads that work well in scale out. So there are some workloads you can split in little tasks, and tasks run independently, and then you merge the sub-result together. Embarrassingly parallel problems work like that. Counting clicks, doing a sum works like that. But anything a bit more sophisticated, a calculation with a non-linear aggregation that requires mixing data from both sides, collapses very fast when you start to scale out. And for those problems where what you want to do is running split second was used to take hours, and including complex calculations, quantile and statistics, you really lose all the advantage of in-memory when you start scaling out. And that's why there are some use cases that require speed on large volumes that work so much better on a scale-up system. In short.
So obviously for you to manage your own memory, is that the whole concept?
Yes. buffer heap memory is a piece of memory that we manage ourselves from within Java. Exactly.
Outside the JVM.
The memory is allocated outside of the heap. It's not the JVM that manages it, it's us. But from within Java.
And you have got pointers on.
We manage pointers from within Java. But as Nida said, it sounds like dangerous and exotic, but in fact, you're all doing that without knowing it. Many, many, many common libraries and frameworks today do have heap memory behind the hood to offload the garbage collection.
Just to add something that will be disclosed later on, is when you are off heap, you suffer less from the garbage collection. The garbage collection won't come and see what's happening off heap. So this is the key. But we will come to the garbage collection story later on.
Certainly.
I hope so.
So if we return to our use case, so our objective was not just to fill terabytes of memory. Our objective was to deliver interactive calculations that aggregate terabytes in seconds. Right. So it means that parallel computing is the other hand of the equation. We need to use those hundreds of cores, not just memory, to solve our problem. But of course, when you run hundreds of cores, it is not really a multi-core issue anymore. It's like a new problem that sometimes is called many-core parallelism. And over the years, I can tell you that we've tried all of the usual paradigms to improve parallelism inside ActivePivot. For instance, we were one of the first software to really use the four-join pool way before it was made available in Java 7. You may have heard of the four-join pool. It's a special thread pool that can divide work recursively into smaller and smaller tasks and run them on as many threads as possible. So it maximizes the usage of the cores. And also, the four-join pool can do work stealing. So when a worker thread has spare cycles, it can go and steal a task from another busy thread, also to maximize the usage of the cores. So I can tell you that about 5 years ago, using the four-join pool really helped us push the limits. And thanks, Dogly, for this great piece of software. And something else where we see a lot of improvement also was to move to lock-free programming algorithm, because nothing will waste your parallel algorithm as good as well as a mutex under contention. So through time, we have written our dictionaries, our queues, our indexes in ActivePivot around lock-free data structure. And each time, we are unleashing a bit more parallel power, if you want. And in the end, we also removed the locks from our transactional engine. It means that thanks to multi-version concurrency control, MVCC, there is no synchronization anymore in ActivePivot between the threads who write updates to the data and the threads that read the data for the calculation. Right? So it's a bit like there are several versions of the data at the same time in ActivePivot. And I could keep talking about everything we did for the rest of the night, but let's not stray too far from the core subject, because all of those optimizations there, anyway, they're not enough. Of course, they helped us follow the hardware trend. We started on processors with 2 cores, 4, 8, 16 cores now. But when we were profiling the largest applications of our customer, we were already seeing that this design would not scale much further. We knew that it would not be good enough for servers with hundreds of cores that at this time we thought were far away in the future. We didn't know at that time.
That's why 3 years ago we totally redesigned our software to move from the multi to the many cores era. If you look today inside the modern servers, what you will see is that you will have a CPU that is associated to a memory chip. And those CPUs and memory chip are somehow organized in a distributed fashion. So what we have to do is to partition our ActivePivot database. And the idea is to keep every partition within accessible only by one CPU. That CPU will only access to that partition, will allocate the memory there, will be when we do calculation or when we do query, we will just segregate and work within that partition. So we won't go and see what's happening somewhere else. So we literally mimic the hardware topology while rewriting our software. That is quite interesting, because what you do here is you move from a multi-threaded code to a mono-threaded code. So you simplify your code really, and you don't, you avoid doing managing the synchronization to the shared resources and the contentions. We can move to the next one. Okay, so this is this screenshot. Let me just tell you the story for this screenshot. For this, we were firing a query dealing with 12 terabytes of data. And this screenshot has been made on the Spark server we were working on. And so this is just the state of all the threads of that server. I can tell you that the Oracle engineers were quite amazed when we saw, when we reached this state. One may say, okay, are all the threads doing effective work? Let me give you the proof of that. So we can see here that we did few benchmarks. So three benchmarks. For the first one, what we did is we start using quarter of the machine in terms of CPU, and we were dealing with 3 terabytes of data. Then we move it to 6 terabytes of data. Then we move it to 12 terabytes of data. And every time, from one test to another, we were adding 1,000 threads every time. And then we reached, actually the screenshot that has been made was for the purple test. So we had the query response time equal to 24 seconds. So it means like, yeah, we had some work that has been achieved by the server and we received the response. When you look at this benchmark, the interesting thing to focus on here is we kept adding thousands and thousands of threads. And we had a certain result. If you are familiar with the multi-threading programming, maybe you had some tests and you did it at 10 threads, it was working fine, and the day you want to do that on more threads, you will maybe reach a plateau or maybe the performance will collapse. Here it's not the case. So it's quite important.
This is the Spark one, so there are 32 processors, each one has 8 cores, and each core can run 8 hardware threads.
So you ran on 32 processors?
32 processors, yes.
So in all it's 3,076?
3,000.
So 8 cores, right? You said?
8 cores per processor, or something like that.
So, just to understand, if it's perfectly scalable, in the ideal world, it should be...
You're absolutely right, yes.
Of this course, is not perfectly scalable.
This is not perfectly scalable. Like in a perfect world, yes, you will have a... You keep multiplying, but you have always something acceptable. So here... But the good thing is from the first test, I mean, we multiplied, if you look at the green one and the purple one, we multiplied by 4, but the response time is just multiplied by 2. So it's quite impressive for this large-scale type of test.
Previously, you told me every core can access or your the memory. So doesn't it mean if I ask that or your one of my processors will be really, really busy, and maybe that's the reason 24 core became so slow?
So I think it will be. Are you talking about the NUMA?
No, I'm talking about you said that one core can access just one memory. And let's assume, or I don't know, this case, core is just one access that particular area.
I'm sorry,
can you rephrase it a bit? Sorry, just to... So one core? Yeah, one CPU can access certain memory?
Even if you have 24 cores, one of them will burn. Because I always want to ask their particular audio.
all the cores work at the same time and all the cores can read from memory at the same time.
That's yes, what I want to read from that particular area which is possible or not for. Two slides before, you said that you make a partition. So here you said that one core can access one allocated memory.
Yes.
If my test case always want to ask that core, always want to ask that particular memory, that means my test will be much slower even if I have 20 or 43 processor which is not running.
Well, yes, but this partitioning is dynamic. So the partitioning is done by looking at the topology of the server to maximize concurrent access, parallel access. So do you want to take it offline after the talk? I would like to talk with you on this. Because there is more to, I have more to share with you. In fact, in ActivePivot, we don't just split the data in partitions. We actually care about where in the physical memory the partitions will be put. You know that all of the big servers above 1 terabyte of memory, they all follow a non-uniform memory architecture called NUMA, where the memory chips are in fact distributed among the processors. And if a processor reads data from its local memory chip, the performance is optimal. But if a processor gets data from a remote chip, then the performance is degraded. So NUMA in this regard is both an issue and an opportunity. And I have learned the hard way in the beginning that if you don't care about NUMA, you can get a very expensive server with 4 sockets to run slower than a laptop. And it's almost very easy to do that. But in the opposite, if you leverage NUMA properly, then you can aggregate the memory bandwidth of each of the sockets. And you can scale the throughput of the memory together with a number of processors.
Right.
And maybe those considerations may seem overstated to you, because it's true that operating systems manage to smooth the impact of NUMA on standard workloads. But for an in-memory database, really the memory bandwidth is the major bottleneck. And so NUMA is a key point as important as the power of the processor, for instance. And that takes us now to the real problem, how to support NUMA in Java. Well, you know that, I was showing you what a 32-socket, a 32-processor would look like with respect to NUMA nodes,
right?
So you know that when a process allocates some memory, calling malloc or mmap, it's in fact the operating system that decides where physically the memory will be allocated. And on Linux or Solaris, the default policy for this kind of allocation is to put the memory on the same NUMA node than the processor running the thread. That's the default policy. The idea behind that is that probably the thread will reaccess this memory quickly, and in that case, the performance will be optimal. And you will see simply that we have based our entire NUMA design on this key principle.
Okay, first of all, we have to detect the NUMA topology. So to do so, of course, we have to do some system calls. What we did is we relied on Java native access, which is much easier to use if you compare it to GNI, Java native interface. So for Java native access, if you want to call, if you want to make a library call, what you have to do is to implement an interface that will have the same method signature as the library you want to call. And then GNA will do the binding for you. So what we did is we did this for NUMA lib for Linux. We did the same for the lib pthread. This allowed us to, for a running thread, have access to the NUMA node ID on which that thread is running. We're also able to access the NUMA topology, how many NUMA nodes, etc. So we had all the tools we need to get that running thread and pin it to that NUMA node and keep it there and just access the data available to that NUMA node. By doing that, we minimize the communication inter NUMA node and we maximize the bandwidth, the socket server bandwidth. If we look at the benchmark we did earlier, just if you look at the last one, we can reach more than half terabyte when we were performing that query. Without NUMA, this is without the NUMA aware implementation we did, this is almost impossible.
So in other words, right, you are calling a C library to do the first touch memory faulting placement.
Yes, that's right. We are using a Linux system library from Java.
So which I can see.
Of course, there is no magic. Huh? There is no magic recipe. Somehow you have to interact with the low system libraries to understand on which type of topology you are running.
Yes. But the good surprise was how easy it was to do that.
With the GNA.
Yes, so you see, we are not that far from processing data, 1 terabyte per second. I'm sure next year we're going to do that. But at this stage, normally, you're probably asking yourselves, what about garbage collection, right? And we're getting there. Sure, thanks to our off-heap memory, we only need a 3 terabyte heap. But of course, 3 terabyte is still way beyond the comfort zone in Java. And I don't think we could have done it just by ourselves. I mean, we felt the need to get closer to the guys who make Java to get this working. And talk to the guys at Oracle, IBM, Azure, who actually write to JVM. We make technology partnerships with them. And in the beginning, they have helped us to find the best set of JVM parameters to run such a large JVM.
Time to take some photos. So without the help of Oracle engineers, we're not able to, of course, reach the perfect parameters, the perfect arguments for our JVM. The idea here is quite simple. If you focus on the rules of the game. Finish the photo. Good. Then we'll leave it for you if you want.
Guys, this video is, the session is getting recorded, so you can just see it on Engineers.SG. So don't have to take a photo.
Yeah. Okay. But you can take pictures of us because we won't be.
Okay. There is only one main rule when we were playing with the garbage collection. It's to never have full GC. What we noticed is, globally, the garbage collection algorithm, they scale well till you hit the full GC. When you hit the full GC, it was over, game over, then you have to restart the application and then keep testing the new arguments and keep tuning your JVM.
What do you mean by full GC? Fully?
Yes. Full GC, full stop the world GC, yes, cleaning both the young and the old generation.
It's like you pause totally the application and then you keep cleaning all the garbage, basically. But so I will just detail few of the arguments we found useful. So actually we were playing at that time with the JDK 8. And we had to find a garbage collector algorithm that is able to continuously clean the garbage. For that, we focused on the garbage first, G1 GC, which will be the default for the JDK 9. Also, we had to use a big young generation. Remember, when I mentioned the off-heap, all the raw data of our in-memory database sits off-heap. Those are the long-living objects. We don't want them to vanish. We want them to stay there. However, the transient memory that is related to the queries, which is related to the calculation, we wanted to go in the young GC and remain there. Then it will be easy to collect. So basically, we use the Java heap as a big young generation. So that was our approach. Actually, the fact that we disabled the adaptive size policy is just to allow us to size properly the young generation. Then the other problem we faced is if you are collecting the young generation, and at the same time, while collecting the young generation, at the same time, if you have transient object, our fear was that those objects will be directly put in the old gen. So the idea was sizing and putting a big survivor, so then those transient object remains there, and then we can collect them easily. Here, by setting it equal to 1, it means half of the young generation. And the last interesting point was to continuously doing what we call marking the different regions. So what we, as far as we reach 10% of heap, we start the marking the objects. So we are continuously doing that marking, and as far as we reach 20% of garbage, we include those object part of the garbage collection. We hoped a lot when we used this parameter, but with no luck, it didn't. This actually max GC post milli is a kind of threshold. It's a target that you want to reach for the JDK when you do your post, but this wasn't efficient for our for the memory size we were playing with, or for the JVM we were playing. So to be sure that those arguments we set are good for our testing, what we did is we left overnight the application running, and we simulated long and short queries. So we were stressing our application. And the day after, we came and we were looking at it. Of course, we didn't have the full GC, so we were happy. And then we noticed that the pause we had was around 10 seconds. Which is, we were really amazed by such result, and that we found the magic cocktail in terms of arguments for the JVM. Okay,
that's enough for one session. Let's talk about the other JVM.
Yes. So of course, when I say all of the JVM, I was talking about the JVM was the one from Oracle, what we call the hotspot. We tested another JVM that is made by a company called Azul, and the JVM name is Zing. Maybe you heard about it. This JVM claims to be poseless, and it's a fork of the hotspot. But the garbage collection algorithm is called C4. They have their own garbage collection algorithm and they invest a lot on it. So we did the same stress scenario. So if you remember well, I had exactly almost the same shape, but on the x-axis, the unit before the hotspot were in seconds. Here they are in milliseconds. So it's really poseless. However, there is no magic. Huh? What we noticed is most of the time, like 10% of the time related to the garbage collection activity is spent by the CPU. So you spend really like on, if you have 3,000 threads, so 10% is just working just on the GC activity. And here we have side by side on some queries, the response time that we have with the hotspot and the response time we have with Zing from Azul. So as you can notice, even if this JVM is poseless, sometimes we can be 2 times faster than Zing with a hotspot. So there is no silver bullet here, and all is related to how critical is your application, and of course, Zing is not free of charge, you have to pay for it. Huh? Side note.
It's like you have to choose between short pause times or max performance, but that's right now. You should know that it's only the beginning. I told you before that we had built partnerships with the big Java players, and for instance, since 1 year, Oracle has allocated a special team of JVM engineers who try to optimize G1, the G1 garbage collector, using ActivePivot as a reference benchmark for in-memory application. And so the engineers who write ActivePivot work together with the engineers who write the JVM. And together we are trying new ideas to improve G1 on such real-life big size workloads. And I can tell you that in the current build of Java 9, of course we're doing that in the Java 9 branch, some parts of G1 run already 10 times faster on big servers. So it's quite impressive, and I cannot disclose too much tonight because, in fact, that's going to be announced at Java 1 in September. I'm going to join Bernard Traversin, the head of Java Engineering, and together we will present our results and the improvements that our work has brought to Java 9. Right? But still, I think we can still give a quick preview of the results. So we are showing you results from 3 months ago. So we have already improved that a lot. Those were the results we had in Java 9 3 months ago.
So as you can see, if we focus on the GC activity and GC poses, you can see that we moved from 4 seconds, something like maybe 3 seconds in average, to something close to 1, which is quite impressive if you compare to the other slides we had before. And if we focus on, we took here just one of the biggest queries we had to deal with, so we can see that we moved from 33 to 18 seconds. So there is a lot of hope to really improve thanks to this partnership, and being close to those guys who are writing the GC algorithm is really priceless.
Maybe the most important aspect for real application is that, you know, those outliers, they were from times to times a very long 300 seconds pause, those are completely gone in the new Java. It may be even more important than the reduction in the pause. Okay, so all of that means that we can all go home and do the same on our own 16 terabyte servers. If you had asked me this question last year, I would have answered no, like everyone else. But today, I consider that the border is crossed. So here comes a new generation of applications that Java can take over. Applications that are operational and that require continuous interactive calculations over large amounts of data that change in real time. And this is going to be quite an adventure, of course, and if you want to be part of it, I think there are many ways we can work together and all over the world. So please make the connection. But in the meantime, thank you very much for your attention tonight. Big more time?
Yeah, I think we have three questions.
So are you making use of any feature of the JVM that you require a separate license from Oracle?
No. This is the OpenJDK branch we're working on. The one free for everyone.
The hotspot you can download on
using OpenJDK and not Oracle JVM.
But Oracle itself is OpenJDK, has an OpenJDK base and a few of improvements. The work we are doing is in OpenJDK. It's for everyone. So when you get Java 9 next year and you say, "Oh, garbage collection is so much better," remember that it's maybe.
Okay.
Do you think other languages can do the same?
Any language running on this JVM, I expect, will benefit from the better G1, Scala or Clojure, for instance, will benefit from it. Yes, that's certain.
I have a question from the other way around. Did you try to reduce the number of classes or objects in your code, actually, or did you have any experience with that, or did you focus only on JVM?
Oh, no, yes, we played on every cursor, yes. Bigger objects, reused objects, anything that can minimize the pressure on GC, we have been considering it. But really, the best design we found in the end is to keep every long-lived object off heap and keep every transient data that is used by queries and calculation in the heap, where even if you create a lot of them, they are cleaned very easily. The young generation is a brutal parallel piece of garbage collection that works well, even on many objects.
The old generation
Oh yes, the old generation is very small because every big structure of our database, so as Nida said, hash tables, columns of numbers, vectors of simulation for the Monte Carlo stuff, all of that can be put off it. So we really keep a small amount, a small old generation, like not even one third of the heap in most of the time.
And the garbage first, which was maybe not that efficient in JDK 7, now is really doing an amazing result. Even on I played with on servers with like 500 gig of RAM, you can see that moving from a parallel origin to G1, you can see really an improvement, really. And you don't fall in that stop the world type of pose.
Oh, you still do. Yeah. Less often.
Really less.
So what's the biggest memory you run so far, 16 terabytes?
That's our record. So bring it on. I'm sure we will do better in the future, but we only do what customers actually ask us to do.
So what is your next target for this, after this?
The target is not the size. Again, we don't try to beat records. We want to be able to do what customers actually find useful doing. So today, 10 terabytes, that's about what some of our customers want to do. But what we really want to achieve is smooth operation, very smooth operation like this. So we try to work with Oracle so that they improve their garbage collection. We try to work with Azure so that they improve their performance in the presence of good garbage collection. That's our goal, really.
Thank you very much.